How are beloved Dr. Rishikesh Pai? Welcome, doctor.
Thank you. Thanks for calling me.
Yeah. Very warm welcome to you, sir. Very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. Welcome, doctor.
Yeah.
Also, we have our eminent speaker, Dr. Ritu Santwani. Welcome, madam.
Yeah. Thank you, Sankal. Thank you.
We also have our COO, Mr. Amit Mehla, with us on the special show, and our director, Mr. Dipin Verma. So, welcome, sir. Welcome, Amit, sir. And over to you, Amit, sir.
So, very good evening to all of you. A teacher takes a hand, opens a mind, and touches heart. Very happy Teacher's Day to all. So, just to start with, I'm sure many viewers are new as far as this edition of Pundi Show is concerned. So, just to give a perspective, Pundi Show is a platform for experts as well as young doctors. And Pundi Show is the only show which has been running continuously for the last 4 months on every Saturday and Sunday. The perfect mixing and mingling done by Dr. Ritu Santwani is very unique when it comes to handling basic questions as well as advanced questions. Not only for doctors from India in Pundi Show, but across the globe are getting benefited. And Pundi Show has been covering all aspects, be it gynecology, ops, sexual wellness, women's health, medical-legal aspects, and current pandemic, and others. And Indian as well as doctors, expert doctors from across the globe have been sharing the knowledge as far as Pundi Show is concerned. So welcome all in webinar series of Pundi Show, evolution of IVF over the past 3 decades. It's a great privilege and honor to welcome Dr. Rishikesh Pai, sir. Welcome, sir, in Pundi Show.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sir is a renowned personality and versatile doctor. And really, doctor, you are a teacher of teachers. Sir needs no introduction. He's a very well-known name in medical fraternity. So welcome, sir, again, as far as Pundi Show is concerned. Sir is a medical director of Bloom IVF Group. Sir is a president-elect for FOCSI 22-23 and administrator of FOCSI Manyata Initiative. Sir is a director of corporate affairs, International Federation of Fertility Society, and adjunct assistant professor of Eastern Virginia Medical School, USA. Sir is postgraduate teacher in gynae at DNB examinations and visiting professor in ops and gynae, Manipal University. Sir is having keen interest in infertility, endoscopy, IVF, ICSI, egg freezing, and genetics. Sir has been having awarded with many accolades and awarded with esteemed fellowship and endowment of FOCSI, Royal College of Ops and Gynae, London, UK. Sir is past Secretary General, Senior Vice President, and Deputy Secretary General, Treasurer, and Chairman of FOCSI, and past President of ISAR, IAG, and MOGS. Sir has been awarded with more than 30 awards, including prestigious Lifetime Achievement Award for Outstanding Research in Reproductive Health by Indian Society for Study of Reproduction and Fertility, 2019, and awarded by FOCSI, Indian Medical Association, and other reputed organizations. Sir has delivered many orations and invited as faculty across the world. Sir is editor of over 16 plus books and written more than 50 chapters. Sir is editor of Indian edition of British Journal of Obs Gynae, BGOJ. And sir is founder chair of Indian SIG, ASRM. Sir is having numerous research publications to his credit. Welcome to you, sir, again. Thank you for having in the show.
Thank you.
Now I'd like to... Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Now I'd like to take privilege to introduce Dr. Ritu Santwani. Dr. Ritu is specialized in field of IVF and infertility. Dr. Ritu is having 20 years of experience in field of ops and gynae and director at Pune Test Tube Baby Center. Dr. Ritu is having expertise in field of IUI, ICSI, IVF assisted hatching, egg embryo donation, surrogate mother, male infertility, semen banking, embryo freezing, sexual and psychological problems, and always try to give moral and emotional support when it comes to dealing with infertility patients. Now I request Dr. Ritu Santwani kindly for the further proceedings. Over to you, Dr.
Thank you, Amit ji, for the kind introduction. So friends, here today we are again with one and only one, Dr. Rishikesh Pai sir, the teacher of teachers. Sir, a happy Teacher's Day to you.
Thank you.
I'm very grateful to sir that sir is so humble. Sir accepted the invitation. Once only I told the sir, you have to come on my show. Sir ne to mujhe immediate bol diya, haan, yes, of course I will come. Sir is always there for us and sir always believe on the knowledge sharing. So I want to ask some questions to sir, but I will ask that all questions after the sir presentation. Sir is in this field from more than 3 decades. So sir is today going to share with us regarding what's the evolution of IVF in the 3 decades. Sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ritu. I want, first of all, I am grateful to all of you for inviting me here on this lovely day of Teachers Day, which is a very important day in our life. Every year we think about our teachers, and the journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step. That's what Lao Tzu said. And I have divided the story of IVF into 3 parts. The past, that is from 1944 to 1992. 1992 is very important year because that was the year when ICSI breakthrough took place. And I thought that 1992 onwards, there was a change after ICSI was introduced in the world. So the first decade, I would like to discuss it. And when I'm talking to you, I'll tell you about my life also, because my life is very much intertwined with the evolution of IVF. If you look at the beginning, in 1944, Mencken, there was a lady, and Dr. Rock, who actually was the discoverer of oral contraceptive pill. Mencken was employed by Dr. Rock, and she was in the lab one day, and Rock used to take out the eggs, and Mencken used to give them to Mencken in the lab. And then, you know, during his hysterectomies and all, he used to aspirate the follicles of the ovaries, and Mencken used to then take the sperm and drop it on the petri dish. And she was dedicated, but she never had a fertilization. One fine day when she was dropping the sperm, after that she slept on the microscope. And 2 hours later, when she got up, there was the first cleavage. And that was this embryo that you see on the screen. This is the first documented two-cell embryo photograph in the world. It was taken in 1944, and this is in the Conway Library at the Harvard University. 1953, Chang et al. Demonstrated in the rabbit that IVF could be done. So Chang was the people who demonstrated that IVF fertilization could be done in vitro, and the embryo could be put back, and a rabbit was born because of that. And that was how the first concept of IVF was established. In 1973, the first biochemical pregnancy was established. And the great Carl Wood, I remember when Carl Wood and his wife had come to Mumbai, me and Dr. Rishma had taken them to China Garden for lunch. And I was conversing with Carl in those days. And he told me, Dr. Pai, I get up in the morning at 5 o'clock. I read the journal till 7 o'clock. Then I go for tennis, 7 to 8 o'clock. I come back, take a shower, and then go to work at 9 o'clock. And he said, I have done this for 40 years of my life. It was a fantastic lunch I had during, you know, in those heady days when I was a bit younger. Carl Wood, Felix Litton, and Alan Thompson. These are the 2-3 masters, and they had the first biochemical pregnancy. And in 1976, the first IVF pregnancy, it was an ectopic, which was done by Steptoe and Edwards. Incidentally, Dr. Steptoe was a great gynecologist, and he had just started doing laparoscopic sterilization. He was my father's very good friend in those days. And because of that, Dr. Edwards was interested, and he approached Steptoe and said, can you use your laparoscope to take the oocytes out, because I need to do oocyte fertilization. And that's how Steptoe and Edwards got together and started doing IVF. And then the pioneering work of Sir Robert Edwards, Dr. Patrick Steptoe, and Mrs. Jean Purdy were resulted in the first test tube baby, Louis Brown, who was born on 25th of July 1978 in Oldham in Greater Manchester. This is the photo with all the nurses. And unfortunately, Dr. Steptoe and Mrs. Jean Purdy died, and that is why they could not get the Nobel Prize, because they don't award it posthumously, because all three of them were equally responsible for the IVF. In the beginning, of course, after the first baby, in 1978, Subhash Mukhopadhyay, in our own city of Calcutta, he was doing a lot of work, and with very primitive, but he was a very great scientist, and he actually had a frozen thaw embryo transfer. And that was Kanupriya Durga. And it's a world's second, but unfortunately undocumented IVF baby. In 1979, Steptoe and Edwards had the world's second documented IVF baby. He was called Alistair MacDonald. In 1980, in Australia, the world's third IVF baby, Candice Reed, was born. And I have written it down because this is where I was trained. Ian Johnson, I loved him. He was my boss. He was such a generous man. You know, I went to do my fellowship with him in 1989-90. And I used to be really, I didn't have money. And I used to be very hungry. And I used to go and eat, you know, sandwiches, you know, they used to have sandwiches in the operation theater of Royal Women's Hospital in the morning. I used to quickly go before all the doctors came, ate the sandwiches, and I used to only eat dinner. But Dr. Ian Johnston and Alex Lopat, they were great people, and they were the first to have the first baby in Australia. It was the third baby of the world. And then in 81, 14 pregnancies and 9 live births were born. And this was through the Carlwood group, which was, so there were two groups, the Monash group and the Royal Women's group, both were located in Melbourne. One was in Monash, which was a suburb of Melbourne. In 1981, the first US baby was born. Elizabeth Carr was her name. And Dr. Howard and Georgiana Jones, they had retired and they had started this IVF unit in Norfolk. And they used to work with Dr. Bob Edwards. And actually, there was an embryologist called Lucianda Week. And she was the one who published the beautiful atlas. It was like a Bible to all of us. All the embryos, we were fascinated. I had that book. It was in the IRR library, and I used to leaf through the book and see all the embryos and the diagram which Lucianda Week had beautifully published in the book. In 1983, the first frozen embryo transfer was done again by Alan Trounson. Unfortunately, Alan Trounson was a great embryologist, and he was Carl Wood's embryologist. And I knew him because when I was in Melbourne, I had a friend called Henry Sandanathan, who used to do electron microscopic work on oocytes, endometrium, and he introduced me to Alan Trounson. They had the first frozen babies in 1983, but unfortunately, that pregnancy aborted. In 82, another very intelligent man, Richard Fleming, he started using GNRH analog. It was in the form of spray, nasal spray, and I used to use it a lot in my olden days. It was a fantastic GNRH aconitase analog, and it was naphthalene, but now it is no longer available. And this is, he proposed a long protocol. In 84, Zoe Leyland was the world's first slow freezing baby. He was born and from an embryo which was frozen for 8 weeks. And again, this work was by Alan Trounson and Carl Wood. And this is Alan Trounson, and this was his landmark paper, which was in Nature, where he reported the first pregnancy following slow freezing of embryos. In 1983, the ultrasound guided transfer, you know, Susan Lenz was there. She started using, because before that, laparoscopy was used for doing ovum pickup, and it was too traumatic. Repeated patients undergo repeated laparoscopic pickups. And so Susan Lenz did a transvesical approach. Of course, it was quite traumatic because she had to go through the bladder. And then Norman Gleicher, you know, he's a very famous for DHES. He used the transvaginal approach, but he put the transducer on the abdomen. In 1983, at the same time, Alan Trounson got the first pregnancies with donor oocytes and donor embryos. And Casper, you know, he started using HCG for luteal support. And then Dellenbach's group in France were the first to use transvaginal ultrasound to do oocyte retrieval, and that really changed. So it was one of the landmark things that happened in 84. In the same year, Ricardo Ash was the one who discovered GIFT, and he also had in 85 the first MISA IVF. So he aspirated the sperm by a MISA technique and then inseminated the eggs and got a pregnancy by MISA IVF. In 85, Eshri was born. Robert Edwards and Jean Cohen got together and started the Eshri. In 86, Dr. Paul Devra, he's also a very good friend of mine. He came, and he's a very good friend of India. He came to India so many times, and he did the first ZIP pregnancy. 86 was the first frozen oocyte pregnancy. When I went to Melbourne to do my fellowship, Christopher Chen, in 1986, just before me, he had come gone to Melbourne from Singapore, and he is one of the biggest IVF guys in Singapore. He had the first baby with frozen oocyte, but he couldn't replicate the you know, because it was a slow freezing technique, and his that he couldn't replicate that in the subsequent patient that he did. At the same time, in 84, I entered as houseman. I was houseman and registrar in KM, and my bosses were Dr. Joglekar and Dr. Indira Hinduja, who was the great god of IVF, and I got exposed along with many others in that time. I got exposed to the IVF program. I got exposed to her dedication. She used to take rounds, and then she used to have this patient, and we used to do the pickup, and then she used to collect those in the test tube, those follicular fluid, and then she used to cross across to the IRR, which was another building across the road from KM. There she used to scan them, and there was a lot of dedication. And in 86, the India's first scientifically documented test tube baby, Harsha, was born. And the credit goes to three individuals, Dr. Indira Hinduja, her very close friend, the late Dr. Kusum Jhaveri and Anand Kumar, who was then the director of IRR. He was a great scientist himself. And in 87, then IVF with Susie was done by Laws King. In 87, I also got married to Dr. Rishma. I, at that point in time, was in Nair Hospital. I was doing ultrasound, and there was this, that was one of the first ultrasound machines in the municipal hospital. I was an ICMR research fellow. I used to do a lot of abdominal ultrasound. I used to measure the femur length, biparietal diameter. I used to measure the liver, abdominal circumference. And then I was lecturer in Nair Hospital, and I was wanting to start IVF because I was exposed. And in the meantime, there was a conference and Henry Sandhanathan had come down for that conference. I met him. I took him out for dinner. And I remember he, me and my great friend, Dr. Salgaonkar, we all went for dinner, dancing. And I begged Henry, please help me to go abroad. I want to learn IVF. And he introduced me to the great Dr. Shan Ratnam, who was running a great IVF center in Singapore at that point in time. And the Ratnam team came to Chennai and did the first IVF workshop at the Shifa Hospital. That was, I think, in 1989, Jan or something. I attended that workshop. I talked to Ratnam. I said, sir, can I come and, you know, work in your unit? Arif Bongso was there at that time. And Rohana Hatatua was there in that group. And there was another guy called Ananda who was there. So they all said, come on, Dr. Pai, you can definitely come. There's no problem. And the meantime, I'd written a lot to all the people. And I got an invitation from Melbourne to come for fellowship. At that same point, there were a lot of IVF programs that were started by Dr. Sadhana Desai Hansotia team, Dr. Kamini Rao, Dr. Kamala Selvaraj, Dr. Sulochana Gurnashila, Dr. B.N. Chakravarti, Dr. Kochar in Delhi, Dr. Swarankar in Jaipur, Firoza Parik, Narvekar, Malpani, Jatinsha, Sanjay Patil. All of them, during the same time, between 85 and 93, all of these people started IVF centers all over the country. In 88, Sherman Silver, again, he was a great friend of my dad because my father was director of family planning, and Dr. Sherman Silver was the greatest man who used to do reversal of vasectomy, and he did the MISA and did the first IVF following MISA pregnancy. The first surrogate birth was of Alice, and this was done by Linda Kirkman for her sister who didn't have a uterus. So the sister's egg was borrowed and the donor sperm was taken, and the first baby was born by surrogacy. Embryo biopsy was done by Alan Frauenson in 1989, and laser was used by Tardir for the first time to do zona hatching to improve the pregnancy rates in 89. In 89, I flew to Australia to do my 1 year's clinical fellowship in reproductive biology at the Royal Women's Hospital, Melbourne in Australia, under Ian Johnston, John Magnin. All of them have now retired. Then the youngest man there, he was my boss at that time, Dr. Lyndon Hill. He is the director of one of the world's largest IVF centers called Virtus Corporation in Australia. In 1990, GnRH trigger was used for as an LHC by Lowell Bonin. 91, GnRH antagonist was used by Rini Friedman. PGD was done in 89. A fantastic work was done by Alan Handyside in association with Dr. Winston in Hammersmith Hospital. And he did the biopsy and he did X-linked disorder of cystic fibrosis. And he did the first birth to PGD. At the same time, Jack Cohen in New York, he did assisted hatching. They used to do assisted hatching with acid thyroid solution at that point in time. Some of them were doing mechanical hatching because the laser had not evolved by then. Then came the in vitro maturation in 1991. Dr. Cha did it. So in patients with a lot of follicles, you know, PCODs used to hyperstimulate, they got the eggs out. He used to do it by aspirating the oocyte. Suppose the ovary was removed, he aspirated the oocyte, aspirated the follicles, then isolated the oocyte, matured them, and then fertilized them. And then, so with all this, the IVF was standardized. And there were a lot of indications for IVF. There was bilateral block tubes was the main indication, but endometriosis, PID, you name it, and that was applied. And the PRT therapy was done. Patients with PCOD were treated, hydrosalpinx were disconnected, endometriosis, fibroid were treated, adenomyosis was treated, all these things evolved. Antagonist protocols came in, and the stimulation was done with antagonist protocols to reduce the risk of hyperstimulation. Ovum pickup was done by transvaginal route, as I told you, because everything had evolved. Sperm selection was done by either a swimmer technique or a double density gradient technique. Of course, nowadays you can do it with other new techniques like MAC or microfluidics. And IVF was done with a standard technique where you incubated the oocytes and the sperms, and then after 24 hours you dissected the oocytes, put them in a dish, and again you cultured them. After 2 days you had 4 cell embryos, after 3 days you had 8 cell embryos, after 5 days you had 150 cell embryos, and you took those embryos and transferred them back into the womb to get pregnancies. So the miracle of IVF continued. By 1990, there had been 90,000 births resulting from fertility treatment. In 2000, the figure stood at estimated 900,000. And in 2007, at 2.5 million. At present, more than 5 million babies have now been born worldwide with the help of fertility treatment. Half of them in the last 6 years. The number of babies born through ART is now about the same as the population of a US state such as Colorado or a country such as Lebanon or Ireland. This indeed was a great medical success story. And this is one of the early ESHRI conferences where you can see me standing along with Rishma and Nandita, and there is Dr. Bob Edwards and the great Dr. Yuri Berlinsky, who has this very great Institute of Genetics in Chicago, which I attended in 1998. And so the whole story of IVF was there and it got established. Everyone was doing IVF as a regular thing. And then the present, that is, I had classified present from 91 to 2019. So what was the present? I came back and started my IVF program. In 1992, the first ICSI baby was born by Gian Palermo, Andre von Stiertegam, Paul Devroy, and Hugh Joris. And all of them, they have been my friends over the years. TESI ICSI birth for non-obstructive azoospermia was performed in 1993 by Sherman Silver. And the first birth following recombinant FSH was done by Benning. The first birth by recombinant LH was done by Lumai in 1994. And in 1993, my first IVF baby was born. It was a gift baby. In 1995, I met Dr. Nandita Palshetkar and I partnered with her to start the Bloom IVF group. In 1995, I went to training for ICSI. At that point in time, Firuza Parikh had just got the first baby. It was born by the Azmoop team. And the Azmoop team, who had invented ICSI, they had the first workshop. When I went to Azmoop in Brussels for the first ICSI workshop, there were 12 ICSI workstations. Each workstation, there were three of us. And there was Dr. Herman Tunney, and there were all the embryologists who were transmitting the beautiful video workshop from the lab, and we were all trained in ICSI. It was a fantastic experience. After that, I went to UZ Ghent in Belgium, where Professor Marc Doorn, he was a fantastic man. And Dimitri Dozhestev, I used to call him Dima. He was a Russian, and that's where I learned ICSI. I came back and installed the third ICSI machine in the country. And it was the first motorized Nikon Narishige machine in India. In 1995, Cohen did the aneuploidy testing, and spermatid injection was done by Simon Fischel. And again, in 1996, me and Rishma went to the Scheussmann Institute in Belgium, where I met the great Petrer Wander Zwellman and my good friend Martin Nies, who is a fantastic embryologist. In 1996, our first ICSI baby of Bloom IVF was born. They were from Delhi. And every time I go to Delhi, I don't talk to them that often now, but they phone me up, both the parents, and the child has become a young man now at present. And this was done by our group of Pai Palshetkar, Sudesh Kamat, our ICSI embryologist, and Khandwala, my sonologist. And this is Giaparo Palermo, who did the ICSI. He was a discoverer. He's a great guy. And the story of ICSI is also there. ICSI is done for multiple indications, for male factor, failed fertilization, azoospermia, PGD, immunological factors, for thought sperm, which may be grossly impaired, fertilization of oocytes that are frozen, ejaculatory dysfunction, paraplegic males. And this is the technique, but I think the video is not working, so I'll push it off. Another great breakthrough came in that time, and that another great embryologist was David Gardner. And Dave Gardner is also from the University of Melbourne. He went to Colorado and there he devised this beautiful classification of the blastocyst system. He derived that sequential media with the concept that the first 3 days the embryo needs more of pyruvate, then the next 2 days, that is the day 4 and 5, it needs more of glucose. And today the evolution is such that blastocyst culture is becoming more and more popular. In 1998, when I went to Chicago, I was there in the workshop and I saw this great doctor, embryologist Anna Vega, using laser for cutting the zona. I immediately came back and we installed the first laser hatching. We almost did it on the same day. Me and Firza Parekh installed it in 1998. And of course, it can be used for multiple, especially for patients with repeated IVF failures. It has got a fantastic place. One of the main powers of IVF is the embryo transfer technique. Of course, now with the ultrasound coming in, more good catheters, more good techniques, almost there is a standardization of embryo transfer. But in those days, every step that you youngsters are now doing, every step I learned, you know, I remember when I was in Calcutta for a conference, I met one German. He said, "Doctor, I take out the cervical mucus." That's how I learned how to take out the cervical mucus. So every step of embryo transfer, as it evolved, I learned it. The vitrification was another breakthrough that came in 2003. And the person who had the first baby through vitrification was Dr. Katayama. And this was his paper in RBM Online in 2005. But the man who really helped me in understand the philosophy of vitrification was Masaru Oyama. And I remember that me and Rishma went to Tokyo in the beautiful, it was November of 2006. And I was really scared. I didn't have much money. And everyone said, "Arey, Tokyo is so costly that going from the airport to the Tokyo main will cost you just 6,000 rupees for the taxi." I was really scared. And as luck would have it, me and Rishma landed. And it was already 10 o'clock in the night. Everything was shut down. The plane had got delayed. And we took the cab and we went and stayed in the Tokyo. And that's where Masa taught me the beautiful technique of vitrification. And in those same days, the whole EV group had come there to learn vitrification. We all went to dinner on the same day out. And that's how I came back and I started vitrification of oocytes and embryos. And even more than, I think, must be even 80,000 embryos. I don't know how many embryos we have vitrified since 2007. It's unbelievable. And Lutardi in his paper in 2008 showed that when he compared slow freezing versus vitrification, and this was a meta-analysis of 4 RCTs, the odds ratio was 14 or 15.57. So there was no doubt that vitrification had totally taken over the new technique. It was a new technique. It had taken over from the slow freezing, which was not an efficient technique. And hence, as we evolved, our pregnancy rate went to nearly 90% at the end of 3 attempts. So if you have 3 attempts, I tell my patient that 90% of you will take a live birth home. What's new in the present? What is new in the sperm? So in the sperm, we can have what is known as selection of sperm. So this is known as IMC. So you can have magnification. Normally, you do ICSI at 200 times magnification. In IMC, you magnify the image 6,600 times. You can actually measure the sperm breadth, sperm length. You can look at the vacuoles, number of vacuoles, diameter of vacuoles. This video is not unfortunately working, but all this you can do. And we were one of the first in India I'm crazy about, you know, equipment. And, you know, I was looking up today in the internet about manias. And if you are crazy about technology, it is called technomania. I'm a technomanic. And this is another technology which we brought in, which is known as, this is ICSI. But you can see there is a spindle. You can see this white thing. This is called spindle. And this is a new technology we introduced two years back. This is the spindle check technology, which can be, the same technology can be used for spindle transfer as well. So you can see that normally the spindle is near the polar body, but sometimes the spindle may not be near the polar body. And so in those patients, you can take care and see that your injection needle doesn't hurt the oocyte. It also has an advantage, because if you have frozen oocyte, then when you are freezing the oocyte, if you see the spindle and then freeze the oocyte, there is a better recovery. Similarly, when you thaw the oocyte after 2 hours before you do injection, if you see the spindle and then do the injection, you have better outcomes. There is also, in non-obstructive azoospermias, you can do percutaneous retrieval, but in non-obstructive, you can now do micro-TC. So we have a lot of the great andrologist, Dr. Rupin Shah, works with us. And, you know, by magnifying the image, you can see the tubules and you can actually pick up selectively the tubules, and you will get a lot of, nearly 50 to 60% of our patients, we recover sperm by micro-TC. Of course, you can also do regeneration of spermatogenesis. This is a slide where you can show various technologies. And one of the technologies which I'll talk to you about is that in the future, you will be able to create sperms from skin cells as well. What about oocyte? What is new in the oocyte and the ovary? Of course, one of the biggest things is oocyte freezing. And the man, and I went to Canada in around the 2006-07, and Chen Xiang, he's the pioneer of oocyte freezing in the world, and Chen Xiang taught me how to do oocyte freezing. And you can do oocyte freezing for social freezing, you can do it for fertility preservation in cancer patients. We do it a lot in our unit for breast cancer, Hodgkin, non-Hodgkin lymphoma. Prior to they undergoing the treatment for cancer, they come to me and we remove the oocytes and freeze them. We can do it for endometriosis. And we have gone to 20,000 oocytes now. Since 2007, we have frozen huge amount of oocytes. Another technology also being used in our unit is the ovarian tissue freezing. So if patients are wanting to go for chemo or radiation therapy and there is not enough time to stimulate them and take the oocytes out, you can go with the laparoscope and take out the ovary, remove the medulla and freeze the cortex. And that's called the ovarian tissue freezing. And this was first initiated by Professor Jax Donis in 2004. You can also, there are a lot of people who come to us who are poor responders. So in IVF, we have got the normal responder, the hyper responder and the poor responder. So in normal and hyper responder, in 3 attempts, nearly 90% of patients become pregnant. But in poor responder, you have to have multiple attempts. And you know, many of these ovaries are really badly. So there is a new technology that we are using in our lab, which is known as autologous PRP injection. We can use it transvaginally or by laparoscopy. And some of our patients have started responding. And we have had our first pregnancy who has delivered following PRP. She was a patient who had failed 2 times before, and now we are about to do an ethics committee permission, and we are starting a big study of PRP injection in all our 6 centers. It's a multicentric trial which we'll be doing. It's a prospective randomized cross-control trial to see whether PRP really would be helpful in patients of poor response. You can also use stem cells. Of course, that's a bit controversial. Autologous stem cells can be used for, you know, activating the oocytes as well. What about the embryo? What is new in embryo technology? One is, of course, newer techniques of advanced culture and manipulation techniques are evolving. You have embryo selection and you have embryo editing technologies as well. One of the things is, should we freeze everything? Because a lot of studies have shown that if you freeze everything, this was Shapiro's study in 2011, where he showed a very high pregnancy rate if you froze everything and transferred in the next cycle. But if you have freezing, there are studies which have shown that frozen babies have a slightly large for dead, and there may be higher incidence of PIH and all in these patients. So what are the indications of selecting an embryo? One is to improve your pregnancy rate. You need to decrease the time. So you, by selecting a good embryo and putting it back, you can decrease the time taken to pregnancy. You can achieve decrease in multiple births by transferring a single embryo. You can tackle repeated IVF failures, treat recurrent abortions, focus testing of embryos for genetic disease, and enable embryo correction in CRISPR. And there are different technologies which are used for identifying embryos. We have genomics, proteomics, transcriptomics, metabolomics. The standard technique is the morphological technique, which you use with almost all embryologists. And if you have a good morphological technique, you can have very good outcome. Then you can, of course, use the embryoscope. The video is not working, but this is a time lapse, and we introduced it first time in India. It was in 2012. In fact, it was the first machine in Asia at that point in time. And this machine can take photographs, time lapse photographs of embryo as they are developing in the incubator. And because you don't open the incubator, the pH, temperature, osmolarity is standardized. And because of the steady state, you get high quality embryos and you can select the embryos. Nowadays, there is a new technology that has come, which is called IDA score. So by using artificial intelligence, you can analyze the videos of this time lapse and you can select the best embryo for transfer. There's another technology which I introduced into our unit recently in the last 2 months, and this is the ERICA technology. It is an artificial embryo ranking intelligent classification algorithm, and you use an inverted microscope for this. Just before the blastocyst, you are ready for transfer. You just take a photograph and you export it to the server abroad, and the server within 1 minute analyzes and it ranks the embryo. So if you take an embryo like this and you export the image, the server will rank it as green color or yellow color or orange color or red color based on how much is the chance of you having a pregnancy. So if there's a green color ranking, you get a 70% plus chance that patient will get a good pregnancy after the transfer. Another technology is the pre-implantation genetic testing. As I told you, Alan Handyside was the first in 1989 for the cystic fibrosis. He had the way, but now PGTA, now actually the name has been changed from PGD to PGT, pre-implantation genetic testing. And it can be classified into PGT for aneuploidy diagnosis or PGT for single screen defect. And in both of these, there's a huge, so the single screen, we have already done patients for thalassemia, they are sickle cell, where they we have selected the embryos and put the normal embryos back and given normal pregnancies. We have done this in our Delhi unit, and we are doing now PGTA, taking biopsy and patients with recurrent pregnancy loss, patients with recurrent implantation failures, patients with age more than 35, 37, you can do PGTA as a routine testing. But instead of taking a biopsy, you can now do a new technology which we have introduced in our lab 1 year back, and that is called non-invasive chromosomal screening or NIPGTA, where what we do is that there is a DNA which is leaking out into the culture media. So without touching the embryo, without doing biopsy, we can take the culture media around the embryo. It is known as spent culture media, and you can amplify the DNA using a Stanford technology called MALBAC technology, which is called the whole genome amplification using a multiple annealing and loop based technology, and you amplify the DNA. The problems of PGT, especially the biopsy, is that there is a huge amount of false negative and false positive. False negative is what? If you take a biopsy from this area, these cells are normal, but actually the inner cell mass from where the baby will be born is abnormal. But if you take the biopsy here, you will get a normal report. You will classify this embryo as normal when actually it is abnormal. So if this is a false negative, then what happens is that you may transfer this embryo back, and there's a higher chance of either she will not become pregnant, or there may be higher incidence of miscarriage, or worse, there may be an abnormal birth. On the other hand, there can be false positive also, means you biopsy this trophectoderm, which will show abnormality, but actually it is a normal embryo. And you, instead of putting this embryo back, you may discard it. So there's a huge amount of embryos that may get discarded. So these are the problems, and we think that the non-invasive studies, and these are the various studies which are showing concordance rate. Concordance means we take the embryo, do a biopsy, as well as we take the culture media around the DNA amplified, and see whether both the reports are matching or not. So the concordance rate in some of the final newer studies are reaching now 83% to 84%. In our own study, which we had done on about 70 embryos since the last 1 year, and we have had already burst with non-invasive technique, our concordance rate is nearly reaching 80%. And this is a DNA. So it has four steps: DNA amplification, library formation, NGS, and reporting. And this is how we do it. So if you can see here, we take the embryo and we do the biopsy of the embryo. I think it's not functioning. I think it is not. So I'll just go backward 1 minute. So I'll just try it again. No, I don't think it is working. So, what you do is you do a tissue biopsy, you do what is known as DNA extraction from the tissue, you do library preparation, and then you amplify the DNA, and then you analyze the DNA using this. You can see this is a amplification system, and this is the actual NGS server where you analyze the DNA, and you can. So what happens is that it gives you a. There are three techniques which you do for analysis. You can do a FISH technique, or you can do what is known as CGH microarray, or you can do what is known as the NGS technique. The NGS technique, what NGS does is that it analyzes the sequence of the base pairs, and from there it's a very accurate technique. So this NGS technique can also be used to what is known as the ERA test, where you analyze the receptors, and this can also be used for analyzing microbiota levels in the endometrium, which is called the ALIS test. These are the tests which are normally offered by a company called iGenomics. But as we go along, a lot of people may start doing these tests. So So if you look at thin endometrium, that's another challenge. A lot of things have been used for like hysteroscopic adhesiolysis. A lot of hormones have been used, GCSF installation, platelet-rich plasma, stem cells, etc., etc. And you can see here that you can use stem cells to construct the endometrium in many of these patients. Or you can use bone marrow-derived stem cells also to, you know, you collect the bone marrow cells, you culture them, and you don't culture them, you extract them, and then you do a transfemoral, transuterine catheterization, and you inject the stem cells into the subendometrial region via the transfemoral, transuterine route. You can also do what is known as, if there is a very badly diseased uterus in our country, we have tuberculosis or multiple fibroids or severe adenomyosis or absent uterus or underdeveloped uterus, you can do uterine transplant. And the first transplants were done by Max Branstrom. And recently, Dr. Puntamaker has also had a first transplant with a pregnancy in our country as well. And Max has done nearly 10 plus transplants. Dr. Puntamaker also did, as I told you. But the biggest breakthrough came from Brazil, where a cadaveric uterine transplant has been done. And now also, I think one or two patient transplants have come from United States as well. So this is going to be the future. So now, what is the future? So there are various things in the future. One is that what is known as spindle transfer. So what is a spindle transfer? So in patients who are older patients, as I told you, in the older patient, the DNA is there, which is intact. But the cytoplasm is not that good because the mitochondria are not that great. So what we are doing nowadays is that you take the oocytes of the patient and you freeze them, the older patient. After that, in the next cycle, you take the donor oocytes and you enucleate the donor. I showed you that spindle check machine before, so you can see the spindle. So you can just put the needle and enucleate the spindle and create a recipient donor oocyte, which is enucleated. Then you take the spindle from the, you thaw the oocyte, which you have rose. You take the spindle from the thawed oocyte, you put it under the zona and you fuse the oocyte along with the cytoplasm and you create a new egg and then you do ICSI with that and you get a pregnancy. Now already 14, 15 pregnancies have been born with this technique, and this technique can be not only for patient with repeated IVF failures due to poor oocyte quality, but also patient where the embryo arrest is there or the embryo quality is not poor or blastocyst formation is not taking place. This same technique was used by Johnny Zhang in 2016. He has worked with the group from Ukraine, Zukin et al., and he has done pro-nucleus transfer. So instead of doing spindle transfer, you fertilize the donor egg with a donor sperm and you fertilize the patient's egg with the husband's sperm and you create the, on the 24 hours later, both will form pronuclei. You enucleate the pronuclei from the donor oocyte and you enucleate the pronuclei from the patient and you put them into the enucleated recipient whose donor oocyte and you fuse it and you create a new embryo, and that's how you do the, so the first baby born through this technique, especially for mitochondrial disorders, was done by Johnny Zhang. The another very breakthrough work that has come in is from creating oocytes from stem cells. So you can actually convert human somatic cells into what is known as induced pluripotent stem cells. And this work was done by Shinya Yamanaka and Kazutoshi Takahashi in Japan. And for them, that they got the Nobel Prize in Physiology in 2012. They injected four transcriptomic factors into the skin cell and they reverse the skin cell. Normally a stem cell will, you know, divide into a heart cell or an adipose cell or a muscle cell or a cardiac cell or a skin cell. But they took a skin cell, then they injected the transcriptomic factors and they reverse the skin cell back to a stem cell. It was fantastic. And this was done, there are 24 transcriptomic factors. And Dr. Shinya Yamanaka had to do multiple injections to find out what were the four transcriptomic factors that actually caused this reversal. It was a fantastic research work which was presented and he got the. So after this conversion of stem cell, the second part was to convert the stem cell to a primordial germ cell, which is known as PGC. And then another breakthrough took place when Hayashi in 2016 Nature Research published the breakthrough work of converting PGC into a mature functional oocyte. So he created meiosis. See, normally the stem cell is 46 chromosomes. There are only two cells in the body which are 23 chromosomes. One is the sperm and one is the oocyte. So they had to take the PGC that he was created by the iPSC and reduce the chromosomes by a reduction step. And this was done in presence of fetal ovarian tissue or similar chemicals. And he reduced and created meiotic division of it, and he created oocytes. And these oocytes were then injected with sperms from mice, and embryos were created and they were transferred. And the first babies, these are the first mice pups that have been born by oocytes, which were created by mice skin stem cell reversal. It's a fantastic breakthrough technology. And if it is done in mice, I'm sure that within the next 5 or 10 years, it will be done in human. Another technology which I would like to, just before I leave now, I know it's a long time I've been talking to you, and just bear with me. Is it okay? 5-10 minutes?
Yes, Ritu? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's a very...
The technology is the, what is the gene editing technology? And that is, which is, see, normally now the gene editing was very laborious technology. It had, we had to use meganucleases, zinc finger nucleases, transcriptor activated like effector nucleases. These are all enzymes, and they were very clean. Like if there was one project which was to be done by NIH, it used to cost thousands and millions of euros. It was a big thing. So suddenly there was a breakthrough, and this was the form which is known as CRISPR. So we have the CRISPR-Cas9 or base editing or prime editing. These are the new technologies that have come. And you know, the problem was that these new technologies are, you can do a gene editing which used to cost $100 million project, you can do it in just 3,000 euros. So it's become very cheap to do it. And this breakthrough came in by three researchers. I'm sure at any moment now they'll get the Nobel Prize: Emmanuel Charpentier, Jennifer Doudna, and Feng Zhang. In 2014, they brought this CRISPR technology. It's an acronym for clustered regularly interspaced short palindromic repeat. So basically, if you have a target gene, you can create another gene, and you can then inject the gene into the cell along with the, so the RNA you inject along with that, there's a Cas3-Cas9 system, and the Cas3-Cas9 system has an enzyme called endonucleases. So that RNA will go and target the gene which you want to destroy, and then the endonucleases will automatically go and destroy the gene. Of course, now there's a lot of refinement of this technique, and this CRISPR technique has been used in human embryos, but what people are doing is they are using the technique, but they are not transferring the embryos back because it's still experimental, and germline modification has a lot of ethical issues, especially all over the world, especially in the Catholic world. They don't like the embryos to be manipulated. So the understanding is that even if you do all these experiments, you should not put the embryos back because of safety issues. There's a lot of low efficiency, and there's something called off-target mutation. So if you are going to target a particular gene, suppose there's a thalassemia gene and you're going to target it and knock it off, in the process of knocking off the thalassemia gene, you may also knock off certain similar genes in other chromosomes and create more vulnerability to the embryo or the child. And hence, there is a, you know, but now the newer, as I've come to understand, the newer technologies of CRISPR are becoming more and more refined, and there's a refinement. So there is a lot of gene modifications have been done in experiments, and the great man in all this is a guy called Mitali Pau. And there's one of the leading institutes of research in the world is the Oregon Primate Research Institute, which is run by Dr. Mitali Pau, and he is the guy who is leading. And there's also Belmonte and Nyakin. There are a lot of people who are working on CRISPR. Unfortunately, in China, he did biohacking. You know, it is called, without taking permissions, he did CRISPR. And not only that, he put the babies back into the womb. And there was a lot of issues. And at present, he has been jailed in China for doing this. But there are advantages. In the future, CRISPR will be used for creating mutation-free gametes, autosomal, you can treat autosomal recessive, autosomal dominant, Robertson and translocation, Turner's, Klinefelter's, Y chromosome deletion, metabolic disorders like diabetes, gene-related cancers, Alzheimer's, all these can be treated. Ultimately, there is a lot of now work going on bio-reconstruction that is creating artificial ovaries. And what is the reason for that? Basically, what we are going to do is that when we do ovarian tissue freezing in patients who have got cancer, there is a lot of these patients may have micrometastasis of the cancer cells, which may go and lodge in the ovary. So when you take out the ovary and you freeze it, when you thaw it and you put it back, you may put back the cancer back again into the patient. And because of that, what is the new thought process is that you create artificial ovary with a sieve and you dissect these ovaries and dissect the primordial follicles, and you seed these artificial ovaries with the primordial follicles culture, then create the ovary in vitro and then transplant it back. So you avoid the re-transplantation of micrometastasis. You can also create artificial uterus. There's a biobank which is being done by Alan Flake in United States. And there is a lot of other things. But and also there's a lot of work going on biomechanical womb, which was written by Aldous Huxley in the Brave New World, which published in 1932. And he described that process of IVF called exogenesis, where the whole baby can be, you know, developed outside the body. And at some point in time, maybe 5-10 years down the line, the entire baby is going to be created outside. We'll do 3D printing of the placenta. We can already, there is a lot of research work going on for developing. Normally, we put embryos back on the day 5 at the blastocyst stage, but already permissions have been given to do research for creating or prolonging the embryo to day 14 or day 12 to see how the embryo develops outside. And these embryos may then be put into 3D printing, printed placentas, and in artificial enclosures like this you can see here. And this can ultimately result in the evolution of exogenesis technology. And this is, of course, Dr. Edwards, 2010 Nobel Prize. But remember, there were two other people, Dr. Steptoe and Jean Purdy, who also should have got it. And that's our great Subhash Mukherjee, our great Indira Hinduja with the Dr. Rishma, and our great Yuri Varlansky with me, Dr. Rishma, Dr. Nandita, and Edwards. So this is the story till now of this wonderful technology of IVF. Because IVF is a, you know, what differentiates IVF from rest? Because it's a real time. Suppose you're working in a lab which is doing COVID test, but you are working with a disease. You understand? Here, you are working in an environment where you have a clinical part as well as you have a laboratory part. It is a lab with emotions. So this is how you differentiate IVF, and that is why it is a fantastic and a very attractive field. Thank you for a very patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for such a detailed elaboration. Sir, there are a lot of nice talk, Dr. Aparna Bajpayee, Dr. Archana Dwivedi, and so many.
Thank you.
Is it any more query? Is it any queries there, Vaibhav? Or should I... Vaibhav, is it any queries in the Facebook? Sir, because what a lot of the viewers from the Bangladesh and Lebanon will join via Facebook. So that questions are coming there.
Okay. Yeah. No problem. I am sitting here. I have no problem. I can keep on talking, giving ideas, thoughts. You know, my talk was more of a general talk rather than specific.
No, sir, very inspiring. Very inspiring, sir.
One of the things I want to do now when the COVID lifts up is to do free education as well. I want to educate. I remember, you know, I was just now in the morning when I got up, the first thing I did was I phoned, because I wanted to know. I phoned Dr. Kamini Rao. I phoned Dr. All the senior people. And I wanted to know when they started their IVF, what happened, you know, all these things. Because I wanted to have an understanding of it. And I feel that, because I've gone through that and I lived through that. In fact, one of the things I personally feel when I look back, I did was I actually created the awareness about IVF, and I should not be boasting about it, but I was one of the people who was responsible for making IVF available to all the colleagues. You know, my first workshop I did in 1992-93, where there were a lot of people who came and attended my workshop who all have big, big IVF centers. And, you know, that time I was, when I came back from Australia, my dad was not a gynecologist. You know, I was one of the few people at that point in time who was not a son or whatever of a gynecologist. I had no backing whatsoever. So the only way I could make some money out of and then, you know, thrive was by teaching. And I was one of the first to start teaching in the country. You know, President Alpesh Gandhi has attended one of my workshops. I remember in 1996, so I've taught a lot of people, and that's how I made some money in my early days when I was broke, and then that's how I evolved myself.
Okay.
So, and, you know, I could also remember that my good friend J.K. Tripathi, I remember him, and I would like to think about him, and he's there who I'm sure is looking down upon us.
He must be very happy. He must be very happy if he see. Sir, a lot of doctors are giving you a lot of compliments. Some doctors have joined from Bangladesh. They are writing, it's a pleasure to know a person like you.
I had gone to Bangladesh, and Dr. Maruf is my very good friend, and they are really generous people. They are really our friends, and we must value all our people. Even I went last year, before I went to Nepal for workshop, I went to Bangladesh, I went to Sri Lanka, and I gave a lot of with Dr. Reshma. And I really, I love those people. I love their culture. All of them are great. They are our friends, and we must cultivate our friendship and our relationship with them.
Yeah. So thank you so much, sir, for your time. So there are more compliments are coming that sir is teacher of teachers. So many doctors has given this compliment. So sir, thank you so much for giving your precious time. Sir, I've done one mistake. The doctor is writing, I'm not from Bangladesh. I am from Saudi.
Oh, Saudi. Okay.
Yes,
Saudi
yes.
is also an important friend of ours. All our people. Saudi is so important. It has helped India a lot. So many of our people are employed in Saudi, and we need to build our relationship with Saudi. It's a very important friend of India. And yes, I mean, yes. Let's not talk about India and all. We are all one big happy family, and we must try to. At present, the war is not with anyone else, but it is with COVID, which is the invisible enemy anyway.
True. So, sir, thank you. Thank you once again from the bottom of my heart for coming in this show and enlightening all of us. Thank you so much, sir. Yeah. Friends, bye. Before I wind up, I want to wind up with these two lines that life is the very biggest teacher. So we have to bow to the Almighty who has given us the strength to how to overcome on these tough times. So thank you to all of you.
Bye.